Hello everyone, friends. In the previous video, we connected to our Home Assistant server devices from different ecosystems Tuya, Xiaomi, and eWeLink operating via the Zigbee protocol. All this became possible thanks to installing a special dongle from Sonoff, which acts as a coordinator of the Zigbee network. With its help, we were able to add relays, sensors, and other devices to the smart home, and now we can control them directly from Home Assistant. If you missed that video, be sure to watch it. There, I showed in detail how to choose the coordinator, how to connect and configure it, add devices, and even update its firmware. And today we will go further. Last time we used the standard ZHA integration. It's simple and installs in a couple of clicks, but unfortunately, it has rather limited functionality. Therefore, in this video, I will show how to install and configure Zigbee2MQTT, a much more flexible and functional system that allows you to work with a huge number of devices, configure their behavior, and even use third-party converters. We will go through installation, configuration, connecting devices, and show how all this integrates into Home Assistant. Why do we need all this if there is a built-in ZHA integration? When you connect Zigbee devices through the ZHA Zigbee Home Automation integration in Home Assistant, it's very convenient, fewer settings, and most popular devices work out of the box. But at the same time, there are limitations. Support for new or less common devices may be weaker. The integration focuses on the general standard and doesn't always fully implement all functions of a particular device. The possibilities for fine-tuning the Zigbee network, routing, and custom converters can also be limited. In the community, people note that ZHA is suitable for simple tasks, but if you need maximum flexibility, they switch to Zigbee2MQTT. If in the future you plan to integrate many different brands and build the most universal network, it's more convenient to choose a platform with wide device coverage and easy expandability. That's why it makes sense to consider installing Zigbee2MQTT, not because ZHA doesn't work, but because it offers greater control and possibilities, especially as your network and devices become more complex. What is Zigbee2MQTT and its advantages? Zigbee2MQTT is an open-source project that acts as a bridge between your Zigbee network and the MQTT broker. The principle of operation: you connect a USB dongle, a coordinator, create a Zigbee network, and devices connect to it. The Zigbee2MQTT software receives messages from devices, converts them, and publishes them in MQTT format. Then Home Assistant or another MQTT client manages these devices. On the official website, it's indicated that 4,678 devices from 518 different manufacturers are supported at the time of verification. Speaking about advantages over ZHA, a very wide database of devices, as you can see, almost 4,700 models and more than 500 brands are supported. This gives you greater freedom of choice and reduces the risk of getting stuck with an unsupported model. Flexibility and expandability: if a device isn't supported yet, you can add a description file, write your own converter, and expand functionality. The community actively participates and helps. Separation of Zigbee network processing from Home Assistant: thanks to the MQTT bridge, the Zigbee network works separately and doesn't load Home Assistant directly, which can improve stability and control. Support for different types of adapters and network configurations: USB, GPIO, Ethernet, and more. Open source code and active development. New device support appears regularly, updates come often, and the community can contribute. This usually happens faster than waiting for proprietary integrations to be updated. I already talked about the dongle, won't repeat myself, you can't do without it. Which coordinator to buy, decide for yourself, links are in the description. I work with the Sonoff ZB Dongle-P, it's already installed in the USB port of my server based on the mini PC SOYOM2, here's the review link. Important: make sure ZHA is disabled. The dongle can work either with ZHA or with Zigbee2MQTT, not both at once. I don't have ZHA installed. Next, open Settings, Add-ons, and Add-on Store. In the official add-ons, find Mosquitto Broker, open it, and click Install. After a minute or two, the add-on will be installed. By default, Mosquitto is already ready to work with Zigbee2 MQTT, but I prefer not to leave the default login and password. So I go to configuration and in the authorization field I write my username and password, username, ZMQTT, password, MQTT 2025. Don't forget to save changes if you made them. This isn't a mandatory step, you can leave these fields empty. Next, go to the Info tab and click Start. Also enable Start on Boot and Watchdog so that if the broker crashes, it restarts automatically. Check the Logs tab, there should be messages like Broker Started. Listening on 1883. And also lines about successfully sending information to Home Assistant. Now let's add the MQTT integration in Home Assistant. Open Settings, Devices and Services, and find MQTT. In most cases, it's detected automatically and links to the installed Mosquitto broker. Done, MQTT is configured and connected with our future Zigbee bridge. Why did we do all this? Simply put, the MQTT broker is the mailman of the smart home. Zigbee2 MQTT will publish events from sensors and devices, for example, motion sensor triggered, and Home Assistant will subscribe to these events and trigger automations, for example, turn on the light in the bathroom. This approach provides a stable communication channel and full control over your devices. Now we install Zigbee2 MQTT. This is the bridge between our Zigbee network and the already installed MQTT broker. By default, this add-on isn't in the store, so we first add an external repository. Go to Settings, open Add-ons, then Add-on Store. In the top right corner, open the menu with three dots, select Repositories, and add the link github.com/zigbee2mqtt/hasio-zigbee2mqtt. Save, close, and refresh the page. The Zigbee2 MQTT section will appear. There you will see three options. The first, Zigbee2 MQTT, this is the stable version, that's what we'll install. The second, Zigbee2 MQTT Edge, this is the developer version with early updates. The third, Zigbee2 MQTT proxy needed if the bridge runs on a separate machine. Open the stable Zigbee2 MQTT and click Install. Wait a couple of minutes until it installs. Don't start it yet. First, find out which port your coordinator is on. Go back to Settings, open System, then Hardware, and show the full list of devices. My Zigbee coordinator is connected to port TTY-USB 0. Yours may be the first or second port, that's fine. If you want maximum reliability, take the long path by device ID. It starts with dev, serial, by ID. You can copy this path directly from there. Now start Zigbee2 MQTT. Open the installed add-on and click Start. After startup, click Open Web Interface. If it doesn't open right away and shows bad gateway, just wait a few seconds and refresh the page. In the initial setup, select your adapter from the list of found devices. The fields with the path and adapter type will fill automatically. If you have the Sonoff ZB Dongle-P, leave type stack. Next, select the Zigbee channel. The logic is this: we need to avoid busy Wi-Fi channels in the 2.4 GHz range. If you don't want to bother, take the 11th, 15th, 20th, or 25th Zigbee channel, that's the golden middle. Save settings and wait until Zigbee2 MQTT restarts. Check that everything started up. Open the logs of the add-on and see if there's a line Zigbee2 MQTT started. If the bridge doesn't start, the reason is almost always the wrong adapter path. Go back, set the long path by ID, save, and try again. A couple more important checkboxes. Enable auto start when the system boots and enable the watchdog so Home Assistant restarts the add-on automatically if it crashes. For convenience, enable show in sidebar. Now briefly why we did all this. Our MQTT broker is already installed and running. It works like the mailman of the smart home. Zigbee2 MQTT will publish events from sensors and devices, and Home Assistant will subscribe to these events to turn on lights, send notifications, or run automations. This connection gives stability and complete control over a large number of devices. Let's talk about common errors. First, the dongle is busy with another component. Make sure ZHA is disabled or removed. The dongle must be free. Second, the wrong port is selected. Use the long path by device ID. Third, radio channel conflict. If devices connect poorly, try another Zigbee channel and move the dongle away from USB 3.0 ports. It's better through a USB 2.0 extension cable. there's less interference. Now let's briefly go over the capabilities and settings of the add-on. When clicking on Zigbee 2MQTT in the side menu, we open the interface with Zigbee devices. I don't have any devices yet, we'll add them later. At the top of the interface, you can enable or disable display of various information, for example, battery status and low battery indicator, handy to know when it's time to change it. Next, the groups section. Here you can create groups of devices, for example, all kitchen lamps or all motion sensors on the floor. It's convenient for quick control or automations. Some devices support OTA firmware updates, there's a corresponding OTA menu item for that. Next item, Touchlink. Zigbee 2MQTT supports the Touchlink function. It allows Zigbee devices that are physically near each other to connect directly, even if they are not yet in your network. Simply put, if you have, for example, a lamp and a remote that are close together, you can use TouchLink to perform a quick pairing or reset. But it's important to know not all devices support TouchLink, and it requires a coordinator with specific firmware. After we add several devices, the interface will show the Zigbee network map, a visual display of all connected devices and their links, routers, end devices, and the coordinator. It's also useful to check the logs. If something isn't working correctly, you can see warnings and errors there. By default, the system is already ready to add new devices. But it's good to check the settings. In the Device Information tab, you can see the Zigbee 2MQTT version, for example, 2.6.2 info about your smart home server, and at the very bottom, your coordinator and its firmware version. On the Health tab, you can check the add-on state, load, memory, and more. In the main settings, there are several useful options. Block list, here you can specify addresses of devices that are forbidden to join the network. Pass list, this is the allowed list of devices. Warning: if you activate pass list and don't add devices to it, all others will be removed or blocked from joining. Use with caution. In front-end settings, you can change the web interface port, enable or disable authorization, or set an access token. In MQTT settings, you can change the name of the base topic on the MQTT server. By default, it's Zigbee 2MQTT, and that's correct. You can also select the coordinator device type and specify its ID, short, DevTTY-USB, or long, DevSerialByID. This is important if the device isn't visible or not found. For beginners, except for setting the correct coordinator port and MQTT topic, most other settings can be left default and adjusted later if needed. Here's an example of the configuration.yaml file for Zigbee 2MQTT. This is the bridge section. It's time to add a couple of new devices. The ecosystem doesn't matter, the main thing is that it's Zigbee. First, I put the device itself into pairing mode. For sensors, it's usually a long press of a button, for relays the reset button or quick clicks, depending on the manual. Then I open Zigbee 2MQTT and click Permit Join, that allows joining. By default, the window is open for about 4 minutes. If I change my mind, I click again, and the pairing stops. While the device is being interviewed, Zigbee 2MQTT may show it as unknown or unsupported, that's normal. Give it a minute, it's reading capabilities, and once the interview finishes, the card turns into a normal one with model, brand, and all details. Here's my sensor, at the top its internal ID, on the right an image, sometimes generic and not identical to the real one, ignore that. The name is generated automatically to avoid duplicates. Below, model, manufacturer, device type, this one's a sleeping end device, not a router, signal level, last activity time, and if it's battery powered, the battery level. If I want, I rename it right now, for example, to rain sensor. Here you can also reconfigure or interview again if it didn't expose all functions, or delete it if needed. Let's add another device, a smart relay. Again, permit join, switch the relay into pairing mode, wait a few seconds, the coordinator finds it, and the card appears in the list. I open it. In the About Device tab, all passport info, name, description, model, addresses. You can edit name and description anytime. The Exposes tab is the most useful, that's what the device really exposes: relay state, power, temperature, brightness, modes. Based on these fields, we build automations and graphs. In state, you see current values that Home Assistant receives on, off, battery level, signal strength convenient to check if the device is alive. Now I'll open Home Assistant Integrations MQTT. I see three devices, the coordinator and two just added. From here you can quickly create automations, check device logs, and an important point, enable hidden entities. Sometimes only basic fields are visible, and the rest are hidden to keep things tidy. If you want to display power consumption or signal strength, just toggle it on, and it appears in the list. If not needed, turn it off again. On the dashboard, you can add a card, a graph, or a switch, whatever fits best. A few practical tips. If a device isn't found for a long time, move it closer to the coordinator or to a powered router. Don't plug the dongle directly into USB 3.0, better into USB 2.0 via an extension cable, it reduces interference. If the sensor is battery powered after pairing, wake it with a short button press to send fresh data. If the card appears but some functions are missing, reconfigure usually fixes it. And remember, permit join closes automatically, that's normal, safety first. That's it. As you can see, the process is simple and visual. Start pairing, switch device to pairing mode, wait for interview, rename it, check exposes fields, and if needed enable required entities in the MQTT integration of Home Assistant. Then it's all about automations, scenes, notifications, and graphs. When Zigbee2MQTT appears in your system, you reach a completely new level of smart home control. Now all your devices from different manufacturers, from any ecosystems, can work together in one common Zigbee network. And it doesn't matter if it's Tuya, Xiaomi, eWeLink, or something else, everything unites into one center, where you set the rules, not the manufacturer. Zigbee2MQTT gives full freedom. You can see each device, control it directly, update firmware, monitor network links, and build automations the way you want. Everything works locally without clouds, without delays, without depending on the internet. Even if Wi-Fi temporarily goes down, the Zigbee network continues working, sensors, relays, and switches still execute their scenarios as usual. And most importantly, compatibility. Almost 5,000 supported devices, an active community, regular updates, and even the ability to add your own converter if it's not yet in the list. It's a living project that evolves every day, and your smart home grows with it. When you install Zigbee2MQTT, you stop being just a user of someone else's ecosystem, you become its architect. The house begins to work by your rules, stable, fast, and transparent. You add new devices, the network only gets stronger, scenarios become smarter, and control gets easier. All links to products are in the description under the video. There's also a link to my Telegram channel where you'll find more interesting gadgets, discounts, and useful info about smart home systems, as well as friendly communication and answers to questions. Also, there's a link to the smart home forum. Topics are organized by sections, so finding information is now easier. Don't forget about the Facebook group. And subscribe to my channel on X, Twitter, there I also post interesting news and collections. Don't forget to like this video if it was helpful and subscribe to the channel so you don't miss new interesting reviews. Thanks for watching, peaceful skies, and all the best. Bye bye.